To our speakers and both our chairs, I see the hall is slowly filling up again because we all know that we have an absolute feast to come up. We have two of the best debaters with a really strong topic. So we have Dr. Gowri Shanker speaking for thiazolidinediones, and we have Dr. Rajesh speaking in favor of hydroxychloroquine, which is a better add-on as a second or a third drug. Now, we know that the mechanism of action is slightly different for both. We know that perhaps one targets inflammation better and that one targets other metabolic pathways. And we know that there is accumulating data for both of these things. So let's see who can convince us. Before I hand over the debate to the debaters, can I see a brief show of hands, please? Who thinks that they would at present prefer thiazolidinediones? And no, the debaters are not allowed to vote. Both of you can't vote for each other. So who thinks that thiazolidinediones would be their second or third line add-on? Okay, one supporter. Two, okay. Who thinks that at present they'd use hydroxychloroquine as a second or third line agent? Okay, so we have 2-0 at present. With this, I invite Dr. Gowri Shanker to make his case for thiazolidinediones. And, oh, we have, sorry. Sorry, as usual, I've been completely left out of the picture. We have Dr. Venkatraman chairing the session. It's partly my age and partly my eyesight. Dr. Venkatraman, could I please invite you up to moderate the session? Actually, we have Dr. Venkatraman and Dr. Vijay Kumar. Sorry, it's my age and my eyesight. Entirely my fault. Dr. Venkatraman, could I please invite you up? I'll go find Dr. Vijay Kumar and come back. Thank you. Everything else is in
sorry. No, you introduced the subject well. I think without wasting much time, only thing is I'm proud that the two speakers whose growth I have seen, the academic front, they are going to debate with each other, and then let them have. I think the format is, we are given about, Usha, about 35 minutes or 30 minutes? 35. So you will debate for about 12 minutes each, that will be 24 minutes. Then a rebuttal for two minutes, that will be 28 minutes. Then we'll have the voting, and then if need be, there will be some summing up. Gowri.
Friends, good evening all. So we will be debating on TZDs versus HQS. Already the vote was high. The number of people are just a handful, single digit, but still we will debate. More people are coming. Another Guru Vijay Kumar sir is there. So when we debate, we will have Rajesh will agree upon, we will have some common agenda of how we are going to debate. Let's make it very simple. We should speak on core pathophysiology, how the drugs addresses the diabetes. It should not be something like you like bitter gourd or I like cinnamon, you give it so that like both the things bring about good glycemic control as well as equally good inflammatory markers are coming. That is not the objective of the debate. Does it address the core pathophysiology of diabetes and where does it affect? Do we have cardiovascular outcome trial for the drug? So is there any good high quality studies for this? Is there any head-to-head comparison between TSDs and HQS? If so, like what they are saying? And we will briefly dwell about side effects. Guidelines, do they have a say? Hope Dr. Rajesh will like this format and hope he is agreeing upon all those things. So as we see the pathophysiology of type 2 diabetes, we have discussed enough about how the genetic defects, beta cell dysfunction are causing diabetes. But one thing which we have been missing over a long period of time is the defective energy balance. As we consume more amount of carbohydrates, these carbohydrates are absorbed from the intestine and they get converted to triglyceride. And these triglyceride go and sit in the liver as well as in the pancreas, okay? So it doesn't like the triglycerides are not getting deposited in the liver as a fatty acid and causes hepatic steatosis and goes into the pancreas and blunting of the insulin secretion coming down. Not only about these things, It is also like the triglycerides which are getting deposited in the liver, the cholesterol esters are taken up by the VLDL, and these VLDL molecules are taken to the pancreas also and gets deposited over there. It causes the blunting of the islet cells, insulin resistance increases, insulin deposition comes down. So that is how the diabetes goes up. So as we tend to eat less amount of carbohydrate, or when the calories comes down, this concept has been dwelled extensively, like be it the diet plan which was discussed in the morning in the workshop, or be it with the drug, whatever is happening, as we try to consume less amount of food, which like people like good people in 2012 Banting lecture was on this, like what happens when your calories comes down. So the calories, when it comes down to as low as about 800 calories, what happens is these triglycerides, whatever which has been deposited in the liver as well as the pancreas, comes down. And the insulin resistance, whatever is happening, it improves. The insulin secretion also improves. So what is needed is we have to shut down, or we have to take away these triglycerides which are getting deposited in the liver and the pancreas. What does pioglitazone does? It does exactly the same. Whatever you are trying to mimic with the less calories, it tries to reshuffle the triglycerides which are getting deposited in the various viscera of the body and moves all those fatty acids from there, from the viscera, to the periphery. This is what the mechanism of TZ is. So as they move with the fatty acids, some amount of water also gets deposited, and that is the mechanism why some amount of fluid retention happens with TSDs. So it banks on the pathophysiology. It addresses the insulin resistance at the level of muscles, at the level of adipose tissues, at the level of liver. No other molecule that we have understood till now banks on this pathophysiology of diabetes. So that is the benefit of TSDs. So do we have any cardiovascular outcome trial to prove these are safe? The first trial, first cardiovascular outcome trial, even before FDA mandated, it was published in the year 2012. It was compared with the placebo, extensive trial, 5,000 and odd subject, done for 3 years. And the primary composite event was huge, like it was involving too many events. So there is a flaw, there is some criticism happening over here. But if you see the MACE the secondary endpoint, which typically involved what we call by 3-point MACE now. So exactly that is where it tried to address. And compared to the placebo, it was showing less amount of CV events. Pioglitazone was showing very, very safe in the proactive trial. So the second is quite interesting, which got published in NEJM in the year 2016, very recent. All that it tried to do was pioglitazone for non-diabetic patients. People who suffered either by a stroke or a TIA were given about 15 mg, 30 mg or 45 mg over a period of time of pioglitazone. And they tried to see the mortality as well as the CV events as well as the stroke over a period of 4 years. So these are all non-diabetic people. All that they had was insulin resistance, which was demonstrated by an HOMA IR of more than 3. So at the end of 4 years, what it showed, the MI, the stroke incidence, everything was coming less when pioglitazone was used. So such an amazing data, no other molecules were able to show statistically significant. And the number of people who are not progressing to diabetes also came down with, these are all non-diabetic. But the number of people over a period of time who progress to diabetes might be increased. But when you used TSZT, so the number of people who are pronouncing to diabetes was coming down. So that was the benefit that was shown with TSZT. The third trial tried to compare with sulfonylureas head-on-head. Head-on-head with sulfonylurea. After metformin, maximum dose given. One single country study, but many places, I think 47 centers or so, 3,000 people. The study went for 5 years, 5 good years, 15, 30, 45 mg again. And at the end of the study, what is important is not only the number of events which was coming down, this was published in the year 2018 in Lancet Endocrinology. Very, very new. So not only the CV events which was coming down, all that we were thinking about bladder cancer, macular edema, fracture risk, everything was at par with sulfonylurea. Number of years was followed up was 5 years. Very good data over there also. Now, head-to-head comparison. So this is an ADA poster which got published, presented in the year 2018. People who had insulin resistance on metformin and sulfonylurea not getting control. 12 people were put on HCQS, and I think six or five people were put on pioglitazone. All they had same amount of inflammatory markers and the same amount of diabetes control. When pioglitazone was used, not only the diabetes control was good, the insulin sensitivity improved, the insulin resistance came down, the secretion also was also very high. So this is, though the subjects were very less, but as we know, like, this is the only head-to-head study available as on now. So we can keep talking about bladder cancer and pioglitazone. I will just quote one quota which was asked by FDA to clear. This is KPNC data, where what they tried to do is 2 lakh people, 30,000 odd people were using pioglitazone. All these 2 lakh people had a carcinoma in them, and 30,000 people were using pioglitazone. And they tried to do how much amount of events can be caused by pioglitazone compared to the other arm. So at the end of this, all this study, this was asked by FDA, and FDA accepted this data, got published in JAMA last year. So it showed pioglitazone is not associated with any cancer. Pioglitazone is not associated with bladder cancer. Maybe it may be associated. That's what they said. They were not able to be categorically sell because they looked at retrospectively, but huge amount of data, 2 lakh people and 30,000 people were on pioglitazone, and they said categorically it is not associated with pioglitazone, whatever the bladder cancer. Now, what do our guidelines say? Do you find any HCQS in these data? Nowhere. So ADA, when it comes to atherosclerotic vascular disease, pioglitazone is approved. When you want to reduce the hypoglycemia, pioglitazone is approved. When cost is the major factor, pioglitazone is approved. ESC, atherosclerotic vascular disease, pioglitazone approved. Non-atherosclerotic vascular disease, pioglitazone is approved. Any place for HCQS, nowhere. ASCE guidelines, again, HbA1c, less than 7.5, more than 7.5, double drug combination, triple drug combination, pioglitazone is approved. Nowhere, HCQS. One of the most good guidelines, NICE 2019 update, pioglitazone. Nowhere HCQS, nowhere update, no international guidelines, nowhere in the book. So I would request Rajesh to talk only about HCQS, not to talk about the ill effects of pioglitazone. We have talked enough about that. So he should not think this is bad. So that is why you use pioglitazone. I want him to follow the same protocol, whatever we have discussed. So I want him to explain the pathophysiology, how it addresses. I want him to quote any cardiovascular outcome trial if it is there. If there is any head-to-head comparison, let him say. If any textbook of diabetes, if it approves pioglitazone, he can always give any data from guidelines. So we will follow this. Thank you.
Senior clinicians and my dear friends, before I could start, I want to profusely thank Dr. Krishna sir for giving this wonderful opportunity. The way my good friend Dr. Gowri ended, I just remembered one comedy from a Vadivelu movie. In the kota dandi niyo varakodada nanu varamaten. Don't talk anything bad about pioglitazone. You talk only good about this. Do not talk anything negative about that. Okay, don't worry. I'm not going to talk anything bad about your molecule. Fine. So, in the next few minutes, let us find out whether I am able to convince you that hydroxychloroquine will be a better add-on in addition to the existing molecules which you use for diabetes, better than even pioglitazone. So let us see what happens. So first of all, my good friend Gowri also forgot that there is a very strong link between diabetes and inflammation. We have a very, very strong link. You see, when there is inflammation, you have insulin resistance, there will be beta cell dysfunction. Eventually, it leads to diabetes. Eventually, when it is not controlled, it leads to diabetes complications, and all your atherosclerotic complications also occur. So there is a very, very strong link between diabetes and inflammation. So what happens in diabetes? You have hyperglycemia, and you also have a very elevated free fatty acid level, and that will actually promote an inflammation by actually stimulating your glucose utilization, and also there will be alterations in the oxidative phosphorylation. And secondly, in high when the blood glucose is very high, there will also be glucotoxicity as well as lipotoxicity. This will exert oxidative stress and endoplasmic reticulum stress, and these stresses will actually incite an inflammatory response. So this we need to understand. And again, type 2 diabetes is also associated with obesity. And what happens in obesity? There will be alterations in your gut microbiota. So your gut microbiome will be altered here. And also there will be increased gut leakiness of the bacterial wall lipopolysaccharides, and that will actually trigger your tissue inflammation. And again, we should not forget about the RAS system. That also will actually lead to inflammation. That also will lead to insulin resistance, and also you will have vascular damage. So we should not forget all these points. So you have a very, very strong association between diabetes and inflammation. And again, so with all these things, we can clearly say that diabetes is actually an inflammatory disease. And if you look into the pathophysiology of diabetes, so now there are 11 pathophysiological defects, and you can see very well your inflammation actually fits in. It has got a birth here. So your inflammation is an important factor which is associated in the pathophysiology of diabetes. And we are all diabetologists and physicians here. We all treat diabetes patients. If you want to get a good glycemic control, if you want to get a durable glycemic control, you have to go and address the pathophysiological defect. Right? I agree with Dr. Gowri. But again, look into that. Inflammation is also one of the pathophysiological defect here. What is going to get, what molecule is going to address that? Luckily, we have another molecule. We have one molecule here, hydroxychloroquine, which was actually used for some other things like inflammatory conditions like your rheumatoid arthritis and SLE. But fortunately, in 2014, you had an US FDA approval for hydroxychloroquine for the use of for use in diabetic population. And in the same year, in India, your DCGI also gave approval for hydroxychloroquine to be used in diabetes. Now, let us look into how your hydroxychloroquine actually acts. I can simply say in 4 points. One is there is inhibition of insulin degradation. Then it improves your insulin sensitivity. And again, we all know the third point, it reduces inflammation. And most important thing is that it preserves your beta cell. So what about insulin degradation? So we all know that the action of insulin is actually limited by your insulin degradation pathway, which is present in all the insulin sensitive cells in your body. So that is why the half-life of insulin is only 4 to 5 minutes. So what happens? When you give hydroxychloroquine, see, there are 3 enzymes which are responsible for this insulin degradation. So when you give hydroxychloroquine, that is an acidotropic drug, so it alters the pH inside the cell, so that your insulin degrading enzyme will not act properly. So that your insulin doesn't get degraded quickly. It is there remaining in the circulation for a longer time for action. So in that way, it decreases the insulin degradation. You have evidence for this. And see, this evidence shows you that when you give hydroxychloroquine, when the concentration of hydroxychloroquine actually increases, what happens? Your insulin degradation decreases. And again, your insulin level also increases. You have evidence for this. And again, I told you, hydroxychloroquine also improves your insulin sensitivity. Just 6 weeks of giving hydroxychloroquine, you can see how much insulin sensitivity is actually. There is almost 20% increase in the insulin sensitivity when you give hydroxychloroquine. It doesn't stay with that. It doesn't stop with that. There is also improvement in your beta cell function. You can see change in your beta cell function. You can see the improvement in your beta cell function, which is measured by your disposition index. That is actually increased by 45.4% if you give hydroxychloroquine just for a period of 6 weeks. And again, your plasma adiponectin level also increases by 18.7%. So you have evidence. And again, nothing more to say about your anti-inflammatory properties of hydroxychloroquine. That's the primary action of this drug. So when you start giving this hydroxychloroquine, all your levels of your inflammatory, all your inflammatory marker levels actually come down. See, within a period of 12 months, you get substantial reduction in your CRP, hsCRP, as well as in your interleukin 6 levels. And again, more importantly, not only your pioglitazone, even there are evidences to show that there is beta cell preservation with this particular drug also. Here they have done a mice studies. They have taken 45 mice and induced diabetes, and equal number of mice, diabetic mice, they have added hydroxychloroquine. And what in the end, what you can see there is that you see the beta cell mass, functional beta cell mass. Beta cell mass actually got increased there. And also your, thank you, madam. and also your alpha cell mass also came down. And all these things are because of the reduction in the pancreatic levels of all the inflammatory markers. So this was. So what happened? When you gave hydroxychloroquine, there is some amount of beta cell preservation, and you have the evidence to show here. And now coming into the efficacy. So looking into all these things, whether this will efficiently reduce your HbA1c or not, you have so many data. I'm just going to project few data. See, here they have added on with sulfonylurea. Patients having high A1c who are all reluctant to add insulin, there they added 400 milligrams of hydroxychloroquine. Within a period of 6 months, you can see there is good amount of A1c reduction, and this A1c reduction was actually maintained even through 1 year. And again, patients who are on sulfonylurea and insulin, they were all not under control. So here they added this HCQ. What happened? 3.3% reduction in the HbA1c within a period of 6 months. Don't get carried away. I'm not saying that it will reduce it by 3.3. Here, because the baseline HbA1c was very high, you get very good reduction in the HbA1c. So here in this particular trial, you can see 3.3% reduction in the HbA1c was there. And more importantly, look into the insulin dose. 24 unit reduction in the insulin dose was there. And again, 30% reduction in the insulin dose was there. And again, here there's a comparison, head-on comparison between your hydroxychloroquine with your teneligliptin. Patients who are all on metformin and glimepiride, if it is not under control, they either added teneligliptin or hydroxychloroquine here, 100 patients in each group. What happened? At the end of 24 weeks, you got numerically better reduction. I don't say it is significant. You can see from your baseline HbA1c of 9.3, 1.8% reduction in your HbA1c was achieved when they used hydroxychloroquine, which is on par with your very potent drug like your teneligliptin, like your DPP-4 inhibitor. And again, do you have any pleiotropic effects with this hydroxychloroquine? Again, you have a study here. I'm going to project. This is an Indian data. And you can see after 24 weeks of giving hydroxychloroquine, we all know that there is a good reduction in your HbA1c fasting postprandial, but what is more important is your lipid parameters, your total cholesterol, non-HDL, your LDL, everything got reduced, and this reduction were all statistically significant. So it has a favorable effect on the lipid profile also. And again, it also reduces platelet aggregation by 11%. And when you combine it with an aspirin, HCQ, when you combine with aspirin, there is 31.2% reduction in the platelet activation. Now the big question, will this give any CV benefit? No, we don't have any clear-cut studies to prove. Dr. Gowri was boasting like anything. See, actually, the molecule which he's talking was a superhero. It is an already established molecule in the market for a very long time. It is one of the topmost molecule. But unfortunately, you see in this debate, with which molecule are comparing? With a newborn baby. So that is not something pride for you. You should be comparing this molecule with a sulfonylurea or a DPP-4 inhibitor or an SGLT2 inhibitor. You're comparing this with a newborn baby. And we have certain amount of evidences. Any drug which is decreasing the inflammation in a long term, that has been shown to decrease the CV events. So that has been shown with other drugs like Canto studies also have shown. Here, I'm going to project one study which hydroxychloroquine, which was done in non-diabetic individuals. We do not have enough data. Done in non-diabetic individuals, rheumatoid arthritis patients, 1,266 patients. Here, they have given this molecule for a period of 12 years. And after 12 years, what you see? Compared with patients who did not receive hydroxychloroquine, patient who received hydroxychloroquine, there was a 72% reduction in the cardiovascular disease in patients who received hydroxychloroquine. Maybe in another few years, if we are able to get a good data, then we can say in diabetic population also. But in non-diabetic population, just by reducing the amount of inflammation, you are able to confer, give such a good CV benefit for these patients. And again, I'm going to end my thing with the Indian data. He said there is only one data. I'm going to show you an Indian data here. Here, patients were all uncontrolled with sulfonylurea and metformin combination. 267 patients, they either added your hydroxychloroquine or Dr. Gowri's pioglitazone. Here, the pioglitazone they added was 15 milligram compared with the hydroxychloroquine, 400 milligram. So this was actually a 24-week study. Look into the results. Your fasting, actually equal amount of reduction in the fasting was there with your hydroxychloroquine and pioglitazone. Again, with your postprandial, you can see even better reduction in your of your postprandial with your hydroxychloroquine. And look into the HbA1c reduction after 24 weeks. You can see it is almost the same. It is almost equal amount of HbA1c reduction. But what happened? All these things happened without any adverse effects of pioglitazone, like your weight gain, like your pedal edema, like all other things which he told not to say. That's what I'm not saying. Okay, fine. So then look into the lipid parameters. All these lipid parameters have been altered favorably. Huge, substantial reduction in all the parameters were there. So what I want to tell you here is that even this hydroxychloroquine addresses the pathophysiological defect of inflammation. I am not saying to use it as a first-line drug. There is no guideline which is advocating it as a first-line drug. You are already adding metformin with a DPP-4 inhibitor, with an SGLT2 inhibitor. See, your DPP-4 inhibitor addresses 6 out of your 8 pathophysiological defects of diabetes. If you add it with metformin, 7 pathophysiological defects of your diabetes is addressed. Then on top of it, you are going to add pioglitazone. What else it is going to do? But on the other hand, if you are going to miss any pathophysiological defect which is contributing for hyperglycemia, like inflammation, in those patients, you select those patients and add hydroxychloroquine, definitely you will get good results. So to end, I just want to emphasize that there is a very strong relationship between inflammation and type 2 diabetes, and hydroxychloroquine brings down your blood sugar like anything, and efficacy is on par with all the frontline drugs, including your pioglitazone. Sorry, I should not say it as pioglitazone, no? So frontline, it is not a frontline drug, okay. And again, hydroxychloroquine, you can see, it favorably affects your lipid profile, and also there are evidences, maybe animal studies are there, to show that it has beta cell preservation. So as I promised, as requested by you, I didn't talk anything negative on that pioglitazone. If you want, we can discuss that also. Fine. Thank you.
You would all agree that it's a wonderful debate. Both of them done an excellent job, frankly. Gowri, you want to have a rebuttal for 2 minutes?
Sure, sir. Yeah. So Rajesh was really passionate in talking about HUQS. See, what he said, new kid on the block. I'm comparing. He didn't understand the topic at all. What was the topic? Which is a better add-on drug? So why this add-on drug came? Because it was all addressing on the insulin resistance. So only two drugs address the insulin resistance. Which are the drugs? It is HUQS and pioglitazone. That is the concept which we have been discussing. It is not like a new kid on the block that it has been deliberately put for the sake of putting, and we want to compare pioglitazone and HUQS. It is which addresses the insulin resistance, because you can't compare pioglitazone with SGLT. The idea of giving SGLT and pioglitazone and HUQS is there is a reason behind that. Second thing, he said US FDA approved. I showed to Vijay Kumar sir, I showed to everybody in the front row, it is not an US FDA approved drug. So it is DGCA approved drug. There is no US FDA approval for this drug and all. So all that he started was it brings down inflammatory markers, pro-inflammatory cytokines, blood sugar. You tell me, Vijay Kumar sir will agree, which reduces blood sugar more, your bitter gourd reduces more. I can show data for that. From ICMR data from Mysore Agricultural University, they have more data for bitter gourd. They have more data for cinnamon. So reducing the blood sugar, reducing the inflammatory markers is not the thing that is important. Beyond reducing all these things, does it has proved any CV safety? Did he show any data for that? No data. There is no data. Did any international guidelines approve this till now? No approval. So then what is all about talking all these things? So as I said, like pioglitazone is a very well-studied molecule, has been there in the market for more than 20 years, and it has got amazing cardiovascular outcome trial. It has showed the CV superiority beyond any doubt compared to HUQS. So that is where like pioglitazone stands.
Rajesh, he's telling about cardiovascular data. Okay, you said that it is no data, that's okay. But about, he feels that, you know, not just glucose control, you have to go beyond that.
Yes.
And insulin resistance is the best thing that he's asking. You are talking about increase in insulin, increase in insulin beta cell mass and activity, everything. But do you have any, you want a rebuttal for that? Again,
correct? See,
minutes?
If you expect hydroxychloroquine to address this insulin resistance, definitely it cannot do. So that is obvious. See. But from your point of view, what I understand is that...
It can do. That is why we are debating.
Wait.
It can do.
To that extent, because that is the most... See, pioglitazone, undoubtedly, it is the drug which is addressing all the pathophysiological defects of diabetes. I don't differ with that. But just because it is addressing the pathophysiological defects, you will accept the increased heart failure in this? You will accept the pedal edema in that? There are data to show that it decreases the bone mineral density and it increases the fracture. There are data to show there are 57% increase in the fracture when compared with the other molecules, like gliptins. So, just because it is addressing all the pathophysiological defect, you cannot accept all the unwanted side effects of this particular drug. And I think Dr. Gowri was not in station. I think he was abroad when this particular drug was banned because of all these. I don't support banning of this drug. That was a knee-jerk reaction from the government. I don't support that. But such a controversial drug, it was banned from the clinical use, and then only that ban was lifted. So think about it, why it was banned. I'm not going into the data of this bladder carcinoma because you asked me not to go into that. But if you want to look into it, the cumulative dose for getting a bladder carcinoma is 28,000. And you are talking about, see, if you say that now and all, you are talking about low-dose pioglitazone. Your pleiotropic effects are there only for high-dose pioglitazone, 45 milligram, not for 7.5 milligram. And in case if you are going to give 7.5 milligram, in 10 years, you will reach the cumulative dose. For an young individual, if the blood sugar is not under control, you can remove it after 10 years. But in case if the blood sugar is under control, what will you explain the patient to remove this drug? So we have to think twice. So it is addressing. I'm not advising you to write hydroxychloroquine for everybody, but look into those patients where inflammation predominates. Those are the patients who are candidates for this. There you consider this, and regarding your insulin resistance and all these things, already your metformin is addressing, already your other drugs like your... all these things are addressing. Hepatic, okay. that is there. So, but you see, when you are combining it with the DPP-4 inhibitor, all the 7 pathophysiological defects are being addressed. So think twice before you are giving this drug for your patients.
Yeah, I see, there are advantages with pioglitazone in the sense that white fat is converted into brown fat. It's a very good fat, sensitive fat and everything. But I think we need to also look into that, know that even prescribing information, they say that New York heart failures, and NIHAs, 2 and 3, you can't. And then it's also said that it cannot be used in 70 plus. And I'm sure that Dr. Usha will tell me that she doesn't use in women because more fractures can happen in... Yeah, so I mean, there are certain issues there. But the whole issue is that I think, in order to clear the confusion, there are some problems with pioglitazone as well. Not that they don't have problems. And fluid retention is a big issue. Bone fractures, you need to consider. And then at least we need to know the contraindications first before indications. That's one thing. And as Gowri said that, we need to have more data from the new kid in the block. And in order to clear the whole confusion, to have a balanced view, Professor Venkatrama.
Nobody is there to vote.
I think for the conduct of this conference, Mohan Sallopandian, Gowri and Rajesh have helped a lot. Krishna, instead of thanking them, he has given a topic comparing pioglitazone with hydroxychloroquine, which I feel is absolutely unfair. So that's a punishment. But one good thing is, in the process, I think some of us learned about this new molecule. Now, I want to tell something about the therapeutics, the US FDA. Vildagliptin is not, in my best of knowledge, recognized by US FDA. All of us are using US FDA, I mean, vildagliptin. We have the verified trial for the in the early stages of diabetes, combination therapy, which is going to make a paradigm shift, in my opinion, with respect to the initiation of treatment. Sulfonylureas, one of the best sulfonylureas is glycoside. Glycoside is least patronized in USA. And most of the weight gain in some of the earlier trials in the West is attributed because of the unrestricted use of glibenclamide. So the bias by the Western people with some of the molecules. In fact, if you look at the chapters written on OHAs, even well-known authors, when they talk about so much about the sulfonylureas, there will be a last one sentence. There is a molecule, glycoside, which is supposed to have some antiplatelet and vascular benefits, which is used in some parts of Europe. These are the two sentences about glycoside. How unjust is it? Third thing, I think hydroxychloroquine is an Indian researched product. Because for you to have data for an Indian research product, it takes time. Example that I'll give is saroglitazole. I tell you, the best molecule in the world, I can bet it, fibrates cannot come anywhere near saroglitazole. I'm not talking for the company for saroglitazole. What I'm trying to say is, in a balanced view, when you're going to approach a molecule, this is a new baby, fine. Now come to the topic. The topic is not which you're going to add on to metformin. Probably what is implied is it's a third or fourth add-on. Now, of course, I'm slightly biased in the sense that I was using thiazolidones like anything. In fact, Vijay and I, we have done so many programs. We have been prolific users of both Rosi and Thio. But ever since the controversy came, I stopped. Of course, that's a personal opinion. You don't have to worry about it. And hydroxychloroquine, I have not yet started. Having said that, when you want an add-on drug, let us say about 5 years of the disease, 4 years of the disease, 8 years of the disease, already you have metformin and a DPP-4 inhibitor on board. You have a molecule because at that point of time, the capture in the HbA1c should be within the capacity of a third molecule, and which should not be a detriment to other aspects. The greatest thing about pioglitazone is its the mechanism of action. I think the very unique mechanism of action, addressing the insulin resistance in the periphery. Beautiful. Probably when it was introduced, the thiazolidinediones, we were so much carried away by the mechanism of action, because it addresses the pathophysiology of type 2 diabetes mellitus. In my opinion, of course, it is very, very far-fetched. Both metformin and thiazolidinediones should be in the pre-diabetic stage. So coming back to the topic, when you have a third add-on, yes, you can identify certain lean individuals who are not candidates for metabolic bone disease, in whom tissue fluid retention is not a problem, in whom probably metabolic bone disease is not likely to be accentuated. This is in the early part of the disease, maybe the first 2 years. Gowri did mention about some of the impressive trials wherein the fracture risk is comparable to sulfonylureas. If I remember right, both for rosiglitazone as well as pioglitazone, the meta-analysis, I think it is unfavorable with respect to the bone risk, number one. And number two, the cardiac failure and the fluid retention. And number three, even in the proactive trial, if you remember right, the fracture risk was more, whereas in the other subsequent trials, it was comparable. So, in fact, when this topic was there, I thought, certainly everybody will say that pioglitazone has got a track data introduced very early, addresses the pathophysiology of type 2 diabetes mellitus. So as an add-on, which I understand, should be a third or a fourth drug, yes, pioglitazone could be a candidate for a subset of patients, but not a liberal use of patients. In fact, across board, as I think Balamurugan just now presented, the only class of OHAs which can be administered from the time of diagnosis of diabetes till the last stages are the DPP-4 inhibitors. Of course, with the dosage reduction, et cetera. None of the molecules are recommended. Now, we are talking about, we are in an era wherein we talk about cardiac failure, we talk about treatment-associated weight gain, and Sriram beautifully highlighted the aspect of the neglected entity of metabolic bone disease. With this in mind, I would caution you. But certainly, if you go for the debate, all of you, many of you agreed, it is pioglitazone. Certainly, I would have been much more happier to chair a debate wherein the discussion has been between maybe Oglibose vis-a-vis hydroxychloroquine as a third add-on. I think that would be much more appropriate. Whereas here, I think you are comparing Virat Kohli with Shreyas Iyer. So Shreyas has just now started in cricket. I'm sure many of you have started your career. So as Rajesh pointed out, maybe in the next few years to come, if you have more data, then probably we'll have better footing to have a debate on this too. But as on date, if you feel the debate, which is the one, certainly it is going to be the pioglitazone with the track record. But only caution is, be careful in using it in patients who are already overweight or obese, in whom fluid retention is a problem. We have got atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease, even though the benefits are there, because when pioglitazone was promoted aggressively, our perception of the entity of heart failure in the diabetic population was not that much as it is now. Now we know that there is an entity of cardiac failure. So a brilliant molecule with a brilliant mechanism of action, which is very, very impressive academically, and HbA1c reduction-wise, all of us have seen it. But the side effects have precluded us from using it as liberally as the other classes of agents. And certainly, hydroxychloroquine, it has just started coming up. The concept looks very impressive, addressing the inflammation, but the number of people tested, the paucity of the data available, do not justify us to place it on par with any other molecule in the therapeutics of type 2 diabetes mellitus. I think this is my way of looking at both the molecules. I hope you agree with me. And then, anything else Vijay would like to add? So, in fact, at one point of time, I was slightly scared whether it's going to be like a WWF with the aggression from Gowri and Rajesh, academic and the academic friends should not transcend into the physical form. In fact, they are such a good friends. In fact, they are part of all my teaching programs. I enjoy both of them. Have so much of academic interest. I would, from the point of view of the debating, I would appreciate Rajesh for the simple reason, because you are talking about a molecule which is very weak. But still, the way you have highlighted, the way you have taken efforts to highlight even the limited data that have been available to us. So in the debate, pioglitazone, in my opinion, has won for the article. But from the debating point of view, I'll give the credit to Rajesh, because your point, your bag, the base in which you are asked to operate was slightly weak. Thank you all. You know.